Drummers Universe.
Hello, Drummers Universe. Hello, hello, hola, bonjour, good day. And apologies, those are the only languages I know. So if I've missed your language, I do apologize. But welcome to the Drummers Universe podcast, the ultimate destination for all things drumming. I'm your co-host, Tony Smith. And with me today, we have our other co-host, Matthew Cleary-Smith. Say hi, Matt.
Hello, people.
And we're thrilled to dive into the vast realm of drums with you guys. In this podcast series, we'll explore the incredible journeys of remarkable drummers, uncover new techniques, delve into the latest gear, and discover the heartbeat behind drumming. In today's episode, we have the privilege of welcoming none other than the legendary René Barthen, a true trailblazer in the world of drumming, with an impressive career spanning over three decades. René has carved his name into the rhythmic landscape, leaving an indelible mark through his extraordinary talent and unparalleled dedication. So whether you're an aspiring drummer, a passionate fan, or simply an eager to have a rhythmic adventure, get ready to be inspired and captivated by the fascinating universe of drums. Join us as we embark on this sonic journey with René Barthen and celebrate his 30 remarkable years of drumming excellence. René Barthen, everyone!
Hi, guys.
Hey, René.
Thanks for having me today.
Hey, René, how are you today?
Well, the weather in the Netherlands is finally sunny, and we had some terrible days. So, yeah, the temperature is rising up again. So, beautiful sky, and then I'm happy as well.
Well, that's all that matters then, isn't it? Good weather, that's all that matters.
Absolutely.
Thank you for joining us today, René. Really looking forward to delving into this podcast with you. Really looking forward to hearing all about your 30 years. We've already heard bits and bobs, and I know our listeners are going to want to hear more and more about you. So without further ado, I'm just going to dive straight into the questions, if that's okay with you. First and foremost, and this is a very straightforward, basic question, I'm sure you can tell us about this one, René. How did you get into drumming?
Well, that goes back for a really long time. My uncle, the youngest brother of my mother, he was already a professional drummer. He played in the Netherlands in bars and dancings in the 60s, near 70s. And he lived in the same street as my grandma, his mom. And after his gig, he put his drums in the hall of the house of my grandma, because he lives on a second floor. And so every time I was going to my grandma to visit her, his drum kit was in the hall. And one day I came into this hall and I saw two drumsticks were on the top of his snare drum in the hall. And some kind of reason, it was sort of a magnet. And I stole these sticks with me. And I was the whole day busy with those sticks. And my mom said, "Where are these sticks from?" I said, "These are from Uncle Andre." "Wow, what?" And, you know, that's where it all started. These sticks. I move on with these sticks. I was hitting pillows and buckets and all kinds of things. And I was in love with those wooden things that time.
Yeah.
And that is really the start of my brains into drumming, playing with sticks.
And I bet your parents absolutely loved you at the time. Am I wrong?
Well, yeah.
With all that noise tippy-tapping away.
Stealing was not a big thing, of course. That was not good. But, yeah, look me where it brought me until today, you know. It started there. So I'm really thankful for my uncle because he was the one who was already playing the drums, every older boss and dancing in the Netherlands. And I'm sure I've got, that's where it all started.
And that's where the passion began. Yeah.
I love that story, Rene. It reminds me of the first time I picked up sticks, how that feeling of like picking up Excalibur, isn't it? Like that, I got that from you just then. It just this moment of complete realization that you need these things in your hands, and you forget after years of playing drums that it actually comes down to the sticks. It's that first time you hold sticks in your hand that you realize that's what you're supposed to do. The drums are part of it, but it's those sticks in your hands, you know, that's it's meant to be, right? Yeah.
A drumstick is the communication from your body to the drums.
That's right.
And in between there's your stick.
Yeah.
That's why a drumstick is not a stick to hit. Yeah, of course it is, but it's more than that. It's a more philosophy. You can get the language to your hand, from your pulse to the drums, to the cymbals, to the hi-hat. That is really bizarre. It's also the violin player who handled this, I don't know how it's called, but he cannot hit it with his hands. You are like the strings, but with the all the hair of the horses, that thing. I don't know the word of it in English.
The bow.
Yeah. And so you can compare this thing with drumsticks, I think. Yeah.
So true. They become an extension of your arm, especially with the way we obsess over it, you know, so they become part of your body. But it sounds to me like you had an incredible journey just with those sticks alone, which shows even more now why you have such a special connection with drumsticks, and you've become such an important part of Vater's history. You know, that's a really interesting thing to hear. I just wanted to ask you a question myself, if that's okay. Just wondering right now, who were some of your first inspirations and mentors on the journey that got you started as well, Rene?
There are several. In Holland, he is very famous. He was the drummer of the Golden Earring, the Dutch rock band. In Dutch is Cesar Zuiderwijk, in English probably Caesar. And but the Golden Earring played a massive role in my journey in music and drums, because they were the famous Dutch group ever and the longest exist. And Caesar was really the man is now 75, but you have to look on the old concerts. He was jumping over in the air over his drums. He made incredible drum solos. He already was messing with electronic devices. Roland didn't exist that time already. And he was already busy with samples. And yeah, he was really the man that I followed for a really long time. Later on, we bought albums, LPs, and singles. And I started buying Toto albums, I started buying Chicago albums, Santana, Level 42 in the 80s, and the list goes on. And you were the drummers that I follow even till today. Absolutely. And what one of my biggest inspirators, and he still is, the British drummer, Simon Phillips, who played 21 years in Toto. And I had the privilege to get real lessons from Simon and follow many masterclasses. And every time when he's in the Netherlands, after so many years, because I met Simon in 1993 for the first time personally. And last month we met again. So yeah, and another one is also what became, that's really bizarre. I was 25, 24 years old, and I got my first masterclasses from Greg Bizionet. And now I'm also with the same brand where he plays on, and that's Dixon Drums. So he's now my colleague, and he became a great friend. yeah, that's really bizarre, because what I always said about myself, I'm still a rookie from the Netherlands, and it's really a privilege to be a part of those guys. Yeah, absolutely.
And would you say that with those amazing talents that you sort of worked with and developed those styles of drumming, would you say that you took a little bit of their sort of styles away in and put it into your own drumming, if that makes sense? Do you see where I'm coming from?
Well, what I found out, and that is also what I tell students to do, is I stole everything from their skills. And so I really swamped over from the next teacher to the next one and to the next one and to the next one. And then you got all the info and how they do it. And then a little piece of myself mix it.
Yeah.
And that became Renee. And that's the way it still works. But I found out, and I think you guys all agree with me, that playing drums, you're never done. It's never done.
No.
If you see the youngsters now, it's really insane. And that will goes on and on and on. It's like sport. The runner who runs the 100 meters. In the early days, he did it in 1 minute, and then became 50 seconds. And now 40, let's say about 10 years, there comes a runner who do it in 30 seconds.
Yeah,
I bet on them.
Absolutely.
And it's also with drumming. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's incredible. And you're so right, aren't you, Rene? You're never done with drumming. You're always looking to find that next little thing, aren't you? You're always working on that one thing, you know, whether that's working on your weak left arm or working on your weak right foot or anything. You're never 100% there. I agree with you. I do have a question that I'd like to ask you about. So obviously you've mentioned the golden earring and all of that sort of, you know, those influences from you. Tell us a little bit about what the drumming community is like in the Netherlands. Do you have, other than the golden earring, obviously, who are fantastic, do you have any stories to tell there? Any influences that you think might be worth talking about?
Wow, that's a difficult question you ask, because the drum community in the Netherlands is a very small country, real small, if you compare it with other countries.
Yeah.
And of course, we do the Benelux, so that involves Belgium and Luxembourg as well. Times are changing everywhere, also in the Netherlands. And that's also for the Dutch drum community. And, you know, I always say this, if you put 100 drummers in a telephone cell on each other, you got a fantastic vibe. But you do 100 guitar players in a telephone cell, then you got a war inside. You know? So we drummers are, the most of the drummers that I know are really kind persons. Mm-hmm. And we got a job to do, and we can battle about things, but still respect each other. That's what I'm feeling. And I'm traveling around everywhere in all kinds of countries doing clinics. But in the Netherlands, that was your question. The drum community changed. There is a sort of, we have a sort of a magazine here, and a sort of that's called Slagwerkkrant. And they started 40 years ago, and that was quite a natural platform. But along the way now, after 40 years, it's all about business. Yeah. And I cannot blame them, but if you're not a part of it, because I call it a monopoly game, and when you're not a part of it, you're out. And not for me, also by me, but, you know, I'm already old, I'm 54 now, but also for the youngsters who has the future. So all the things that happened in that magazine and all the brands who are advertising there. And so if you be a part of it, you're in. If you're not, you're out. You're a boycott, is what we say in the Netherlands. And I think that's unfair. Not for me personally, because I had it and we discussed it many times, but it's the truth.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it's a monopoly game. And I think that's not good.
I get that. And it's the same across the board, really, isn't it? Across the world, the music industry. I mean, it's always been a business, hasn't it? But it feels like it's, like you say, it's all about monopoly nowadays and monetizing everything that's possible. And it used to be that it was a tight-knit community, but now it's just more about these big media, you know, corporations just pumping out content to try and sell as much as they can to. And I think it needs to, you're right, the community needs to come back to the forefront, doesn't it?
That's where things like Drummers, you know, Drummers Universe come in. These communities that we have online are like the nearest thing we have to an opportunity to create results and bring everybody together and do things that we care about as a community, which is awesome. You know, and the great thing about that is, like, we've got Rene here over, you know, people all over the world, basically. We've got the Netherlands here today. I'm in Spain right now. Where are you, Tony? You're in the UK, right?
England.
So right now we're having a conversation all over the world, and it's still a community. We're talking from the heart and discussing these issues. So that's a wonderful opportunity I think we have today if we use it.
I've always a saying, and it's officially a saying from a good friend of mine who said, we are one nation under the groof.
Yes, Rene.
For sure.
And I will repeat that until I die.
Oh, it's so right though. Love it. So right though. I think what I got from the drumming community when I used to play bass guitar, so when I moved over to playing drums, I just found that the community was so much more accepting and inclusive than any other. You know, I've been in other communities. I've played guitar. I've played bass guitar. I just feel the drumming community is just so welcoming, and the people are just so friendly. So, yeah, you're right, Rene. 100%.
I totally agree, really.
Rene, like, the next step of the conversation is asking you about your personal career with different bands. You were with the Bootlegs early on. That was a really important part of your story, and we'd love to hear a bit about Kingdom of Desire as well, your current band. Like, what's happening? Where have you been as a drummer, and where are you now in your projects?
Well, also with my bands, I've been in several bands. The Bootlegs, I was in that band when I was 13 years old.
Amazing.
And you know what? This year we exist 40 years.
Wow.
And we are massive friends. We are brothers, really. It's such a long time. So we are planning a theater show of the journey of 40 years of the Bootlegs. And in that theater show, it's going to be a two-hour show. We started from the beginning, in the mid, until now, with a lot of beautiful stories also to tell and to share and to show, but also the music, because we started in the 80s, and then the 90s came, and then millennium came. So musically wise, everything changed in all those 40 years. And I can tell you that was really a blast. And it learned me, it brought me so many skills. So the Bootlegs was really nice, yeah. And after the Bootlegs, I decided to become a professional drummer. They won't want to become professional. I was already pushing and I saw myself already playing in stadiums and big venues. And so I quit myself at the Bootlegs that time. And I left them after 10 years. And then I came into my second band, and that was Private Eye. And immediately we came in totally different. That was a totally different thing, because in one month further, I was playing in the support act from the Golden Earring.
Yeah.
So first I played for 1,000 people at least, and with the Golden Earring as a support act, thousands of people. So that was a kick, really. That was so cool. And yeah. So.
And then it was Hurricane Joy next, wasn't it? Was that the next sort of era of your career?
Hurricane Joy became my third band. That was the band that we make our own music. We made two albums. And yeah. And things didn't work out in the Netherlands with this band. So we moved to other countries, and it works. And yeah, it was also, and that was my first time playing in a band with their own materials. And we're making two albums. And then we did festivals, and yeah, that was a totally different way of making music in a band as a drummer. Yeah.
What I love about that, and I think this is valuable for listeners, is that it's so easy sometimes to focus on where you live, and there's a big world out there, you know, where you live, the music that you're playing may not necessarily be as popular, or people may not be as interested, but in other countries you get entirely different perspectives on music, and sometimes your style, genre, what you play will fit in much better in a different environment. So it's amazing that you guys took that beautiful music you were creating that you believed in, and you pursued it further and went, well, let's take it elsewhere and see who's into this, and it landed. So that's great, you know.
Well, what I believe, and I still believe, if you want really something and you put everything of your body and your mind into it, you can reach it in the end. And in my case, I think I reached almost my goals. Absolutely. Yeah. And that's really a privilege to. And yes, there were also down stories to tell, of course. And but we went through that. And it's also a learning progress.
How were you touring at that time? When you first initially, I mean, later on it maybe got a little bit more posh, but in the beginning stages, how did you handle the touring process as a band?
Well, that was quite difficult, because at that time you have managers, people who guide you, and you trust them. And in our case, we had the good ones. So also financially, and all the little letters in the contracts. And yeah, you're so young and you want only do one thing, is perform, playing the drums. So later, when I was mid-30s, I found out that a professional drummer, you have to also be a businessman. So I changed. Yeah.
All wise words, Rene. Thanks for sharing this stuff. And then what's happening now? You know, you've done all this crazy journey and you're here doing clinics, and what's happening with your current band? What are you guys doing at the moment?
My current band is a Toto tribute band. It's called Kingdom of Desire. And like I told you, I'm a student of Simon Phillips. Before Simon took the seat over when Jeff Porcaro passed away, I was already a massive fan of Toto, the Toto 4 album and all the albums, the 7-1, and I've got all the records from Toto. And yeah, and I was really digging to this totem music, and it was quite difficult to copy it or to play it. In 1992, Jeff passed away. And
sad day for the drumming community.
Then Simon Phillips came in, and he did a very difficult job to take the seat over. And after the Kingdom of Desire tour was done, they decided, and Simon, that he stays in Toto. And then they were coming to the Netherlands, and I still remember that evening. And I walked into this venue, and they opened the show. And then I saw a guy with a double bass drum and some hanging bass drum and some pipe drums and the octobons. And I thought, what the heck is this? And I don't know what happened, but there's where the magic was started. And yeah, and then I had the privilege to get lessons from Simon and follow master classes in Germany also, and one in England. So yeah, and Toto is, yeah, one of my favorite bands. And 4.5 years ago, I started with Huber, who was a little whiz kid. He still is. He played the guitar. And with together we make this band as the founders of this Toto tribute band, Kingdom of Desire. Yeah. And that's a blast, really.
And Toto's timeless, right? I mean, it's just one of those things that it's never going to get old. There's always new people coming up in the drumming community that get into Toto, because Jeff Porcaro's playing was phenomenal, tasteful, and it's just a timeless piece of, it's timeless work that they did. So it's great that you're carrying that banner forward for people to enjoy live, because there's nothing like seeing that kind of music live. You know, it's amazing having the records, but there's nothing like the experience of being there with the band really kicking it.
Absolutely. It's playing Toto, you know, we all started in a cover band, you know, you play pieces from that band. But now you have to play a whole evening all the songs from one band. So that is really a journey with the whole group to get the sounds, to come so close enough to the original track. And Toto, people who love Toto notice that one of the most difficult parts are the vocals. And but also all the pieces together with Luke on the guitar, David Page, and Steve Porcaro. And it's an institute of music. That's what I always say about Toto. Yeah,
and they've got a very distinct they've got a very distinctive sound, haven't they, as well? And just before I get onto that, because my next question is going to be about the drums that you're currently playing, but I just want to take a moment, just take a second, because we've had a few messages come in, Rene. Just want to take a moment to read out a few messages, if that's okay. If you're not already a part of the Drummers Universe Facebook page, get yourself over there. But we'll be doing these podcasts sort of once a week, or hopefully once every couple of weeks, and we'll have a live chat going alongside. So we have a live chat for Rene today, and we have a few messages of well wishes, really. So we have Christopher from DNA Drums, who's saying happy anniversary, wishing you all the best. We've got,
thank you.
Yeah, we've got Timothy King Fallen Phillips. He says he's a freelance artist, and he's also saying happy anniversary. The general gist is we've got a lot of happy anniversaries going on here. We have drummers from all across the world, Albany, Oregon. We have Australia here, all of these guys dropping on this message to just say, you know, happy anniversary. And then we have happy 30th anniversary. Have a nice big celebration from the Third Room, Australia. So, you know, that's come from all the way across the other side of the world, Renee, which is just incredible.
Wow. And thank you, everyone.
It comes back to what you're saying about the community, doesn't it? It really does. It just shows that we've got such a good community here in our universe.
Outside of the Netherlands, and I was in South Africa in March doing four drum clinics for Dixon Drums. I was in Port Elizabeth, and you felt the, and it didn't matter if you were a beginner, and mid-range drummer, or a pro, or whatever. It was really, they were really one nation under the group. And I was never been there, but it felt like I was home.
Yeah.
It's bizarre.
That's amazing. Absolutely amazing. Yeah. So coming back to the previous question then. So this is the part of the, this is the part of the podcast where you might get judged, Renee. by our members, maybe by myself. No, I'm only joking. So it's a two-part question. First and foremost, what brand of cymbals do you play?
I played many. My first brand that that sponsored me, that was Bosporus cymbals.
Bosporus.
And they are made in, also in Turkey.
Yeah.
And there was a percussion shop, really in the north of the Netherlands, who did the distribution. And that time I was hired at Pearl Drums. And that's where it all started for me. But I had no cymbals.
Yeah.
And some kind of reason I came in contact with those guys. So my first clinic was really playing with Bosporus cymbals. Yeah, that's also a really long time ago.
Do you still play Bosporus today?
No, I don't. In the middle, I had an Italian brand. It's called UFIP.
Yep, amazing brand. They're rotocast, aren't they? UFIP.
Yeah.
Yeah, incredible. No, incredible.
They mounted on a roller coaster, and and I brought it also to BMI. That's the company where I worked for many years. We were the distributor for the Benelux for Pearl Drums, Vader Drumsticks, and New Flip Cymbals.
Incredible.
And also guitars and other things. But I was more from those brands, yeah.
So I think we can all agree that you have unparalleled taste in cymbals. You have great taste in cymbals. What kit do you play at the moment? What's your go-to kit? What are you playing right now?
Well, to finish the cymbal story, we quit with UFIP. And then I met a beautiful lady on social media. Her name is Samaya. And that time in Germany and the Frankfurt the Messe, we had a sort of NEM show, but then in Europe. And then she invited me to come to a booth and say hello. And now I'm with her for 12 years as an artist. We became good friends. And Turkey cymbals is really a blast, and the Turkish family is really a warm bath. And on top of that, I told that yesterday to a guy. In all those 12 years, I've got a bunch of cymbals, and I never broke one cymbals. Even not my splashes, there are still in an amazing shape.
Amazing. And for our listeners out there, where can they go to find these cymbals?
TurkeyCymbals.com.
Okay, so there's a website, so we can go and check them out on the website.
Dreamers.com.
Fantastic.
So, and there you see all the massive, beautiful series. Yeah, and that's where it all started. That's going to be answered your second question. Behind me, that picture, you see a guy named John Blackwell Jr. And John was the drummer of the New Power Generation for 15 years. He was the drummer behind Prince.
Incredible.
John was hired at Turkey Cymbals as a Turkey cymbal artist. And I can tell you that was an earthquake. Mm-hmm. And that was so awesome. And he gets his own signature line, who still exists. And one day I thought, let's find out if I can contact this person, and perhaps he's not waiting for a Dutch rookie or whatever, but let's try it. And I tried. And he responds, and yeah, more often. And yeah, I told him my background story, working more at in the drum industry for brands. Mm. And one day John switched to Dixon drums, and that was also an earthquake.
Yeah.
Yeah. And after a while, I had him, we Skyped a lot, and he said, Renee, these drums are awesome. You have to come to Dixon as well. I said, well, you know, you guys are icons. I'm a rookie from the Netherlands. Who wants to have me? But he said to me, you have to send your resume to Dixon. They can really use guys like you in any kinds of ways.
So you're coming on to our next question there, actually, Rene. Yeah. So before we go any further, so your current kit, you're playing a Dixon. Is it a particular model you're playing?
Yes, I've got. I play on the Artisan series. The Artisan series are a full custom made product. So each drummer can decide his wood material, the lacquer, the finish, the hoops, wooden hoops, triple flange hoops, die cast hoops, no hoops. I don't know. But everything is impossible in the Artisan series.
Yeah.
And we have a motto in at Dixon Drums. We make high quality drums in the Artisan series for an affordable price, and you have to check it out yourself.
Incredible.
And the website of Dixon is called playdixon.com.
Amazing. So tell us about your time at Dixon. Tell us about, we want to hear about it, because over your years, you've not only worked at Dixon, have you, but you've also worked at Pearl. And I know you've got a fantastic story about Chad Smith there, haven't you, as well, with Pearl. Would you like to share that with our members?
I will share you with you guys. You saw the picture with all those little pictures.
Yes.
It's out of my Pearl time. Pearl was with BMI, the distributor, for many years. And BMI was based really over the bridge where I live. And I need to go there. So I walk inside. And I don't know, I was not brutal, but I thought, what I've got to lose, I need to go in there, because I love Pearl, I played Pearl, I bought all the kits, and that's where it all started. And that time I was already knowing that I want to be a product clinician. And I said to the owner, what became later my boss, I said, I can do it better than Cesar Zadovic from the Golden Earring. And he was laughing, and he said, You're totally out of your mind, Rene. Caesar is the best. I said, yeah, he is. But you got a big mouth, my little fellow. And yeah, it was really bizarre. And well, and I was keeping pushing him to give me a chance to do a product clinic show. And then one day, then he said, Rene, I had it with you. In about 3 weeks, you're going to do a show for me. You have to play on our newest Pearl MMX series. And this is the music shop, and go for it. And that evening was really where it all started. I was really scared that evening, and I was waiting for the account manager of BMI that evening, who gave me assistance on that evening, but he was not coming. And then after 2 minutes, I saw the big boss himself with his wife. And then I thought, oh my gosh, it's up or dead. And I played really and talked my ass off that evening. And then he came to me later on and said, Rene, you nailed it. Come tomorrow to the office and let's speak. And yeah, and I was flying under his wings. Later on, I became working inside of BMI. And yeah, I started really in the warehouse, knowing all the separate parts, restores of everything, of all the Pearl parts. And yeah, and then to the picture. One day, everybody know that Chad Smith, the Red Hot Chili Pepper drummer, who plays Pearl. He was Pearl's highest endorsee. Now he's playing on DW. Yeah, DW. And there was a request, and my boss came to me, Hank. He said, Rene, do you know the drum sizes of the Red Hot Chili Pepper drummer? Well, I think I know them, but I can handle it. And he said, will you order a whole set for him, but totally unlacquered? So only wood shells, nothing on it. I said, okay, what are we going to do? I'll tell you later. And after a couple of months, his whole set came in. And the story is this. When the guys are in Holland, they got a bunch of tattoos everywhere. And our tattoo king is Henk Schiefmacher. Henk Schiefmacher is really an artist. I don't know how old Henk is, but he's not the youngest guy anymore. But he knows the Peppers from the beginning. Every time when they're come playing in the Netherlands, they visit Henk. So what happened? Henk came to the office and really want to tattoo that drum kit for Chad Smith, but with a stiff, with a pen. And I still remember that he was coming. And then I said to Henk, do you want to first make a test if it works on a, well, at that time we had cracked shells. So I give him a cracked shell, and then he started. He's really magnificent. And well, the first pencil didn't work. So another one and another one. And finally, he got the one. And he started to create the whole kit. And when the kit was ready, he brought it back to the office. And we make a bunch of pictures of it. And yeah, and then the Red Hot Chili Peppers came to the Netherlands to perform. And then the kid goes to Chet Smith. And I think he still owns it.
Incredible. Yeah. That's an amazing story. Just goes to show, just goes to show your career in the drumming industry is extensive, is it? but no, that's just incredible, Rene. And you know, so much more. You've done so much more after then as well, haven't you? I mean, as far as I know, you're currently designing a new snare drum. Is that correct?
Yeah. In time of Corona, I was infected with COVID-19. I was really sick. It was really, oh my goodness. And I need to stay at home, and I was alone. I need to be alone. And it was a long time of recovery. Mm. Afterwards, there were still restrictions here in the Netherlands that we need to follow up. And then, to get through of it, I was really back to my drawing table again, because when I worked at Pearl, there are still items for sale that I developed. And but I didn't do it for many years. So I thought, let's design something like I did in the old days. And then I thought, you know what? I'm going to design a snare drum. But I'm not a guy of wood. I love steel. Mm. And because in my really youngest days, I was a welder. And so then I draw a whole snare drum first. And then step by step by step, I create a snare drum out of one piece pipe. And my friend owns a company with all these CNC cutting machines. And that was really, really difficult to make that. And finally, we made it. And along the way, I was looking to this picture of John. This skin is always in my office, hanging on the wall. Because, John was, first of all, the guy who brought me into Dixon. And to bring him an homage and to thank him, then I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to make a snare drum in John's name, and that is going to be called the Blackwell. And John's favorite colors were purple and yellow. And there are a lot of purple accents on the snare drum. John's widow, Yuritsa Kamambero, Blackwell, she became a very special friend. I didn't meet Yuritsa, also not in person, John also, only by FaceTime, like we do now. But the snare drum is ready, and what I decide, and also Turkey Cymbals is involved, because there's where it all started between John and myself and Dixon Drums. The snare drum is here. I made a video, and it's go about the story of a rookie, an icon, and the Blackwell. And the snare drum will be sold in an online auction. And that is one of my last projects now. And I donate all the money to the Florida General Hospital where John was treated. So I think that's great cause, what I think.
That is an absolutely amazing applause, and I think deserves a round of applause, to be honest with you, Rene. For our members out there, Matt, you're on mute. For our members out there, when will this sale happen, and how can they find it, and what platform are you selling it on?
The selling gonna be on eBay. So when the time is ready, Yuritsa and I are trying to launch the auction on the heavenly birthday of John on September 9th.
Amazing.
And yeah, and we work hard to reach that goal. And then I post all the links wherever I can, and also on Drummers Universe. It will not be on Drummers Universe, but I will let the people know when it's auction gonna start. Yeah. From Dixon, you get a very special snare drum back that's specially made for this snare drum with the silhouette of John. Turkey cymbals provide John Blackwell signature cymbals. So yeah, and this massive, beautiful snare drum.
Amazing, amazing.
It's a beautiful homage to the man. Bless you, Rene. I mean, there's a lot of commitment that you put into creating that snare drum. And a lot of people don't realize how amazing steel is. You know, steel, you can make some of the best snares I've heard are steel, but people always think brass, you know, they're always thinking brass, aluminium. Steel is an incredible material to make snare drums from, and you can get so much personality and sound. Sometimes it's nice to get out of the beaten track and do a different metal, and then you get a different sound. And so, John Blackwell was an incredible player, right? And an incredible man. There's so many people have lovely stories about how he was, how encouraging he was as a person to other people. I heard stories from people when he went into Berkeley occasionally to, I don't know all about his career, but obviously everybody knows he played for Prince, but it just, you know, everything I've heard about him, there's been such kind words about the kind of man he was.
Yeah. You know, sometimes I got a lot of questions. If he didn't dive, how and what, and you know, so
yeah
it's so young, really, and I have the privilege to communicate with John's wife, the widow of John, Yuritsa, and also she is a great human being, and for me that's really special. Yeah.
It's a beautiful thing you've done, Rene, and someone like John deserves to be remembered. He did so much and cared so much about people.
When people are dead and they are not in the picture, they get lost sometimes.
Yeah.
And I'm also one of the drummers, like a couple of days, weeks ago, it was with Jeff Porcaro. It was the day he passed so many years ago. You see a whole Facebook is responding on, and I think that's good. Must not forget them, you know? So their legacy is so important, and to move on in this whole world where we're living in. Yeah.
So true.
I think that's good.
Love it.
Absolutely.
So, I was just going to pop in with another question, if that's okay. So, tell us about your time with Vater. This is like one of the biggest questions of the interview, right? Obviously, you're wearing the Vater T-shirt right now. We all have heard your tagline multiple times, right? We know what you stand for, how much you love the company. So, you know, maybe you could tell us what you love most about Vater, any good stories you have, and, you know, maybe what's your favorite stick, or, you know, what do you love about the sticks, or what are your favorite brand, you know, models of stick from Vater?
Well, that evening that I had to play on my first drum clinic for Pearl on that MMX drum kit, my boss, Hank, came a week before to me. He said, "Rene, next week when you give your first clinic, we have a new stick brand out of the US. And then, yes, it's called Vater Percussion. Will you promote that as well on that evening and perhaps further with your clinics you're going to do for us? I said, yes, I will do it. And that's where it all started with Veda. In the beginning, I had I still remember an A4 piece of paper, and there were only 20 models available here in the Netherlands. Now, for over, and now 2023, we have over 150 models, 150 models in sugar maple, hickory, and six different chips. Massive. So when I started to promote it, I get further and convinced drummers, because Veda, the brand Veda, is the longest and oldest manufacturing of drumsticks in general. So in the mid 50s, we make already the sticks for Buddy Rich, Elvin Jones, Papa Joe, and all those massive icon drummers from that time. And that story you can read on Wikipedia when you're looking for the Veda brand. The Veda company is really a family company. So it's generation on generation. And the philosophy behind the Veda drumstick is really bizarre. And and you know, what I was saying is this: a drumstick is not a wooden tool to play. This is really what we call math, you know? This is rock and science, or how you what's the word? Yeah. Yeah, I don't know how you call it.
Rocket science, you're right. Yeah, yeah. It is.
It's all about, And one thing for sure, and it's not that I'm with Veda for, because I'm 30 years now also with Veda. But we are, Veda is really, we stand for durability and quality. And durability is so important. And I see still a lot of other brands who couldn't deal with our quality. You have to dig in. I had to show you all the pieces here on this stick. And if you compare it with other brands, then you see why. Yeah. That's
Can
really
I show
true.
You something, Rene, just on this topic? I've been playing Veda for a long time now. My favorite stick is the Super Jazz stick. I love that stick. It's got, for me, it's got the perfect balance of weight and articulation and response, and I just love the stick. I've never picked up another stick yet that's had the, and it's the length of it and everything about that stick I love. Anyway, check this out. You're talking about durability. I just pulled these out of my stick bag. These are ex Veda sticks, not a single one broken. You can see how many rim shots I do, right? I mean, it's torn to pieces in the middle, and then once they start to lose balance, obviously you have to move on, but they never break. You know, they'll lose balance, they'll lose weight. I mean, you'd see these ones as like a beaver attack, the top half. That's just been chewed back, and then I'm like, okay, well, it doesn't really weigh much anymore, and it's starting to lose its sound, but it didn't break. And I've it's been very hard for me to find sticks that don't break when I play big rock gigs and stuff, because I put a lot of weight behind my playing. So they've really, even the jazz sticks can handle that, and that's really impressive, because you normally have to go to much thicker sticks to achieve that. So I personally speaking, I've had the exact experience you're talking about.
Yeah, well, thank you very much. It's always nice to hear the great things behind Veda drumsticks. And of course, there are stories from a Monday morning stick and a break in the first minute you play. Yeah, that can happen with all kinds of things. But if you take it over, in general, our sticks and durability, one of the most beautiful things is to show it is the Jared Falk, the guy from Drumeo, who put 10,000 rim shots over a whole day with I don't know how many drummers to let it break. And it won't break. And they hit the stick so hard. That was really a test.
Yeah.
And yeah, and that's bizarre. And also, if you go to YouTube and fill in the Vader factory tour, you see my big brother, Alan Vader, who was the owner of Vader Company, telling you all the in and outs, how these sticks been made.
I actually watched that one, Rene, was fascinated by that video. It was very interesting because obviously especially your maple sticks are made from quarter sawn wood, aren't they? So that they are selected for their grain and the way the grain, and that's the beautiful thing about Vater, is they take the time to think about the species of wood, but not just the species of wood, but how the grain travels along the width of the stick. It is a bit of an art, and there's, like you say, there's also a science behind it, and it was a fascinating video just watching and seeing how they're selective they are and everything.
Well, yeah, the story behind Vader is much more bigger, because we were already producing sticks before the brand name Vader exists, the brand name. So the brand name Vader exists, I think it was 1991 or 1990. And but before that, we produced the sticks of Vic Firth,
yeah,
for Vic the 80s. And
did not know that.
Yeah, and also the Zildjian sticks, because the Zildjian sticks are still made by Vic. And there comes one day that that's business. I don't know the quiet story behind it, but the collaboration stopped between the family Vader and Vic. Vic started his own company, but because of one of my big friends, close friends, is Dane Marshall. Without Dane Marshall, I think the Vader brand never exists, because he was the guy who challenging the Ronnie Vader and Alan Vader to move on under their own name, Vader. They were the grandsons of Vader. So, yeah, the story is that they continue under their own name. And Dane was already working also for LP and Zildjian, and he had all the contacts. So together with Ronnie in the factory, and Alan and Dane goes all over the world and all the countries where Vader is for sale, promoting Vader. And that's really awesome. And your question, what do I play? I fell in love with this stick. It's the Fusion series type. It's a... with a ball tip. I love the ball tip. Tips, you can immediately hear the difference when you touch your play on your right finger. Then you hear different sounds in tips.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or on your hi-hats. On toms, you have to hear really good, but I really don't hear the difference. But on the cymbals, immediately.
Yeah.
Why do you stick? I don't have really a question of an answer for it, because we have so many sticks, and I can tell you, I need to know all these sticks. Yeah. So my job is always to find for each drummer who cannot find his or her ultimate stick, to find it in our catalog.
Yeah.
So, and there are a couple of tips to find out. But this stick is, for me, is perfect. And the Fusion series was already there from the beginning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Would you, I think just on that subject, because it'd be really valuable. I mean, it certainly piqued my curiosity. I love the sticks I use, but there are many people out there probably still can't figure out what would actually be the right stick for them. Yeah. Have you got a couple of quick tips for our listeners, that things they could take into consideration, or questions they could ask themselves to select a stick that would make them happy?
Well, what I always suggest and tell the Vader dealers, You know, you can go to a shop and to buy a pair of sticks and you come home and you play with your band. No, it's not the right. And get back the next day, buy another one. And that goes on and on and on. And perhaps you're going to find it or not. And that costs you a lot of money. But also for the guy in the shop, okay, he gets his money, but what he wants that you come, when your sticks are done, that you come back and say to him, I need these sticks from you.
Yeah.
Every time. So then you come to agreement. I know drummers are buying their sticks for ages in their stores, you know? So what I always say to the dealers and everyone out there, put a practice pad. You know, when I take a pair out of the box and I immediately start playing my rudiments, I feel immediately where the balance is.
Yeah.
The weight, the reaction. And afterwards, the sticks are not damaged, come back in the plastic thing and go back in the hole with the other sticks. And then you can grab another type of sticks and do the same thing. So then you can figure it out quite easily what feels good. And yeah, and then if you're not can find it, you can also go to fader.com and you got the totally length, you got the diameter, and also good thing where it's called the taper. Where the taper started, we have sticks there is here. So when the taper started here, the balance is much more back because this is the biggest and the heaviest side of the drumstick.
Yeah.
So, like I said, sticks are really rocking science. You know, it's mad. But the answer of your question is to feel it with rudiments. With rudiments, you are really focused on the two hands. If you're playing match grip or traditional grip, you can really find your balance, your speeding, and where is your speeding. And too thick sticks or too heavy sticks are not good for your pulse as well. But we have, and also problem drummers who are sweating a lot. You know, all these sticks are lacquered.
Yeah.
Too much lacquer is not good. And too less is also not good. But we have also, for instance, the Nude series. These are unlacquered. It's only wood. It feels like sandpaper. So when a drummer really dealing with sweating hands, I give him a Nude series pair in his hands. I said, try it. So it's always my goal to find for other people their ultimate sticks. Yeah.
Tony. Just one final thing I wanted to check on before we move on to the next subject. I just want to say, because you said something to me, to all of us or any there, that's just perfectly practical, right? You grab a pair of sticks, get a pad out and feel those sticks, right? Because then you know for yourself, how does it feel to play with those sticks? But would you have any tips with regards to stylistic choices, like depending on what bands they're in and things like that, what you would recommend? I mean, you just said generally heavy sticks aren't necessarily a sensible choice, but I guess it depends on the person, etc. So did you have any further thoughts on just before we move on?
Well, with so many sticks in our catalog, we got black sticks, you know, and wood tip and nylon tip. The black sticks are very famous in the metal scene, you know, some kind of things. We got the Color Wrap series in gold sparkle. I'll get one. Just a second.
He's gone. He's literally getting the catalog.
We've lost our guest.
Well, he made that quick. So he got that to hand. Here he comes.
And this is a blue sparkle. And this is the Color Wrap series. And we got this blue one. We got it in red, in gold. but we got also a sort of silver. And when the lights are on it, it's really beautiful. And it will not go off when you're playing and hitting the drums. It not
I
falls
want
off
that stick. I want that stick. I'm looking at that stick thinking I need that stick in my life.
Tony's going flash.
For all our listeners out there, it's a blue sparkle.
I'm going to use one for you. One stick.
You could match it to your drum set with the collection, couldn't you? Like, go all the way.
No, but back to your question. We got a lot of sticks that can be used in the music style that you play. This you can use in disco or shiny things. I know a guy who owns a gold sparkle drum kit, and his sticks are all gold sparkle from Vader. Wow. That look so beautiful.
Yeah, I can imagine, especially under the stage lights. Under stage lights, and I can just I can vouch for Rene here myself, because I actually we've known each other for a little while now, haven't we, Rene? And I approached Rene quite a while back now with an issue. You know, I underwent an injury with a hand, and my stick choice had to change. And I was going through so many different iterations of trying to find the perfect stick, and it wasn't until I met Rene that boom, I found my ultimate stick. Now, mine is a heavier stick. It's a 2B, but that's for personal reasons, you know. But yeah, I can vouch. And you know, all of you guys listening, I'm sure if you drop Rene a message on the group, he'll happily have a conversation with you. Oh, I might be dropping you in
so you
it
can
there,
find
Rene.
Him there. Good luck, Rene.
Yeah. I'm going to move on if that's okay, guys, because we've only got a few minutes left of the podcast. Time's running short now, so
I'm getting overexcited over here asking all about this.
But I did the final question, Rene. I mean, we've just sat and listened to what an amazing career you have had over the past 30 years. There's so much more in store for us, and there are some questions I just haven't had the chance to ask you today. And hopefully we can get you back on at some point and ask you even more questions. But after those 30 years worth of experience, what advice would you give to the drumming community? What words of wisdom would the Flying Dutchman have for us all?
I have. You know, I always say this. These sticks are my weapons. Not to kill, but to touch your souls.
Incredible.
And that is really the big shout out to the world, and to say, we drummers, of course, we have politics, we have religions, we have our own thoughts, but don't get too much involved with this. We are musicians, because with our drumsticks, we can touch people's souls because of the good grooves we play.
Yeah.
And if you can play a good groove, I get goosebumps everywhere. I love grooves. And my friend Pete Ray Biggin from Level 42 say always, groove pay bills, Rene. And he's damn right. You know, all the chops, and it's very difficult. It's cool, but it's all about the groove. And especially the youngsters out there, you know, sitting behind the telephone the whole day, watching internet, and get a pair of sticks and make music. Let you out of your heart. If you don't read notes, I don't read any note. I eat them. But, you know, but you get there. If you want it, you can fix it. And go in a band, play with other musicians. Don't focus on one music thing. Play the bossa nova, play rock, play jazz, play, and mix it all to yourself, and play what you like, of course. Yeah. And stay open for positive critic. If I say, you play it wrong, you have to play it like this, then you play it right. don't come and argue with me. Or no, that is not my thing to do. No, I want to help you to play it right. And if your stand's open for that, that is the real drum community that I know.
And
most of the drummers everywhere in the US, in South Africa, in Europe, in the UK, you know, it's beautiful to be a drummer. That's what I can tell you.
Yeah, it is. Yeah,
yeah.
And I'm proud of it.
Yeah. 100%. I agree. I think every one of us are proud of it as well. Thank you so much for your time today, Rene. It has been an absolute pleasure hearing about your journey. Now, you know, I know that if any of our members want to find you, they can quite easily reach out to find you on Facebook, can't they? You've got Facebook, you've got Twitter, you've got YouTube, I believe. And
I've got YouTube is Rene the Flying Dutchman. On Instagram, also on YouTube.
Yeah.
Rene Barthén on Facebook. I got only the Flying Dutchman, and you can find me everywhere.
So you're all over the place. Classic Flying Dutchman, yeah. Right there.
Yeah.
So so you're actually, this is a bit of an announcement to our group. You know, we've mentioned it a few times, but. Drummers Universe and Rene Barthén and Vater are going to, is it Dixon, sorry, are going to be at the UK Drum Show on the 29th of September. Is that correct? We're going to be at the UK Drum Show. We're actually going to get to meet each other in person. If you are from the UK, apologies for our American or overseas compadres, but if you're from the UK, the UK Drum Show is happening in Liverpool on the 29th. Now, I'm going to get shot if I've got that date wrong. But I'm pretty sure it's the 29th of September. So get yourself over there. Drummers Universe is going to be there. You can meet the legendary Rene Barthén in person at the UK Drum Show. So absolutely get yourself on down there. We've got some great merch and a few activities that we can get on with as well. And it'll be great to meet some of our members as well. On top of that, there are some surprises in store. Hint, hint, coming from Drummers Universe over the coming months. I won't reveal too much. I'm probably going to get shot for revealing this, but there are some surprises in store. So keep your eyes on Drummers Universe. Keep your eyes on everything that's going on in the world of drums. And for now, I'm going to wish everyone peace, love, and we are what, Rene? One groove?
We are one nation under the
that's
groove.
That's the one. One nation under the groove. Peace, love, respect. Thank you, everyone, for your time today.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for being here, Rene, and sharing your time with us. We appreciate you.